Welcome, everyone. Thank you very much for coming, despite of the weather. Pleasantly surprised to see that many people. Let me introduce myself shortly for those who don't know me. My name is Maciek Pawlikowski. I'm head of digital content unit here in the library. And what we do, we provide digital content, mainly images, imaging related, for different purposes, for readers, for some of the research, and we use various number of technologies to do that. We try to stay on top of what's going on in that regard, or at least be aware of that. And this is why we often invite people who develop the certain techniques or using certain techniques for different purposes. And this is how we met Bruno Vandermeulen from University of Leuven, who will present the Reflectance Transformation Imaging combined with Multispectral Imaging, which sounds like something which hasn't been approached extensively before. So it's fairly new technique, and he's staying with us for 2 days to take some sample images on the objects which haven't been tried before. So hopefully we'll have something interesting to show afterwards as well. But for now, please welcome Bruno and his Multispectral Microdome.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you also for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here. It's also a pleasure to present the work we've been doing the past few years. As said, I didn't come along alone. I brought the portable light dome with me. As you see, it's relatively small. It's portable. It's the microdome. We also have another flavor. It's larger. It's table size. It's the mini dome. But I will present the work we've been doing the past years with this device. First, a few words on what we do at Leuven. We have also a digitization department where we digitize our own collections. We focus on high-end digitization, more difficult material, not mass digitization. And as being a university, we try to collaborate as much as possible with researchers. Researchers to implement also new techniques to advance research, things like the microdome, to develop new tools, and also collaborate with other institutes. When we're talking about multi-light technology, I think most of you have heard about reflectance transformation imaging or polynomial texture mapping, which has been around since 2001. It's a technique of interactively displaying objects under different light conditions, and the object to be captured stays in a fixed position, the camera also stays in a fixed position, and it's the light that moves around. And the registration of the position of the light is with a reflective black ball reflective sphere, but you also have dome-shaped devices. At Leuven University, we've been involved in multi-light since 2003, since the autumn of 2003, for the digitization of cuneiforms. And the first working prototype developed in 2004, first work software in 2005. I also work for archaeologists, so I know what techniques are being used in that area, but I also work in digitization of documentary heritage. So this was an interesting technique, but I thought a lot of possibilities also for documentary heritage. So I started with my colleague Lieve Wotte, a project in 2012, the RICH project, Reflectance Imaging for Cultural Heritage. And the movie you see is the prototype we used in first instance to test things out. It's the larger dome-shaped structure, but I will talk about that more later. When talking about multi-light reflectance imaging, you have actually two approaches. This polynomial texture mapping, or reflectance transformation imaging, and it's a technique to image and interactively display surfaces under varying light conditions. Another technique, second technique, is photometric stereo, and this is what we've been developing at University of Leuven. And the base principle is exactly the same. It's to image objects from varying light conditions, but the basis for the base algorithm is the purpose is to calculate surface normals. It's 3D information. And talking about surface normal, people involved in 3D know these kind of images. It's a 2D representation of 3D information. And depending on the angle of the pixel is laid out in kind of 3D map, like a point cloud in 3D. But according to the angle of the pixel, it has a certain color, and this color can be the angle of this pixel can the angle and yes, the angle can be calculated based on the color. So it's a 2D presentation of 3D information, and this forms the basis of what we do. This will be a bit technical. I'm not the engineer myself, I'm a photographer. I will try to translate it into more readable, understandable language. But the main difference between RTI and photometric stereo is that RTI, it takes an average. You have your object, you have a ray of light hitting that object, and you have some kind of reflectance. If you have a mirror lying under it, there's a lot of reflectance. If you have something like a black cloth, velvet, it doesn't reflect at all. So with excuse me, with reflectance transformation imaging, it makes an average of the specular reflectance and the diffuse reflectance. So what is reflected and what is not reflected. With photometric stereo, we take into account both components, both specular reflection and diffuse reflection. So that's the main difference between those two. And to be more precise, photometric stereo involves more complex math. You can calculate, since it takes into account both the reflectance and the diffuse component of light, we can calculate more accurate surface normals, so more accurate 3D information. It also returns other information, such as albedo, the natural color of material. If you have a material, it might happen that with an angle of light from a low angle, your material reflects a different color than with an angle coming from above, light coming from above. And we also can have some BRDF analysis, but more on that later. The RICH project, as said, started in 2012. We tested the prototype, which was developed for cuneiform digitization, and started discussing with engineers on what we wanted and how we wanted to have this implemented. In 2014, we finished the construction of the white light microdome, and in 2015, this device, which looks exactly the same as the white light microdome, but with a few differences. And software was also adapted. for this multispectral processing. And in 2016, a few more software enhancements have been made, which I will show you later. And at the moment, we're working on a new version of the viewer. Since I work in a library, it's mainly documenting heritage. And as you see in the image in the middle, the device which we used as prototype wasn't particularly suited for safe conservation digitization. You can only put books under it, opened at 180 degrees. So this is something in our construction we wanted to to fix that, because as you see, the construction itself gets in the way for the imaging. And we had a lot of discussions with the engineers, first of all about books and the concept of books, but also how to tackle this problem. So we came up with not a larger device, but a smaller device. That's why it's called the microdome and not the mini dome. The first dome was the size of a full-size room, so that's why the mini dome, which is about 80 centimeters large, is called the mini dome, and this is the microdome. So what's special about it? It's smaller. It has 228 LEDs on the inside, and we can take off a slice. And why is that? So we can position it on, well, we can put a book under it, at which opens at 110 degrees, so we can image into the binding. And it doesn't affect the quality of capture, or the quality of information we capture. So the principle is, it doesn't start, but you see on the right, we have our 228 LED lamps, which light individually, and each time an image is captured. So 228 lights are 228 images, with light coming from light coming from all angles. So hardware-wise, 228 LED lamps. Area of capture is fixed. It's more or less 12 to 18 centimeters. It's about the size of a large illuminated initial. We had to decide on that. We have a capture resolution of about 1,000 dpi. And we use actually a machine vision camera. Video camera, but it's a video camera of 28 million pixels. And why don't we use a normal camera? Because a normal camera has a shutter, has a mirror, and if the shutter goes up, it vibrates. Or you could have vibration, and we don't want that during capture. So it has an electronic shutter, and this version had both an RGB version and a monochrome version, and we needed the monochrome for the multispectral microdome. Lenses, we use a 60mm macro or a 105mm macro, and for the multispectral we use a special kind of lens and with fluorite elements, so that we don't need to refocus with infrared or UV. So we focus with visual light, and it's also sharp in the UV and infrared area. It's the portable light dome, as you see. It's easy to use. It's completely computer-driven. We don't have to touch the device during capture. We just calibrate it, we focus it, and we can capture in an automatic way. Everything is stored in raw format, PGM, which is one of the first raw formats that were developed. Acquisition time is 3 to 5 minutes, and processing time, depending on the either the white light or multispectral, is 20 to 30 minutes. So the software, we can relight interactively. We have a shaded filter. I will show you examples on that. Sketch filter, we have a measurement tool. We have an offline viewer, we have also an online viewer, and we can export images and data. So we have, after capture, we have one file. Our data set is about 5 to 6 gigabytes per capture. After processing, we have one interactive file, and in this case, it's 127 megabytes. We can export screenshots in full size, 28 million pixels, so that's quite high. We can export metrical data, and we can export to PLI format, 3D model, and in this case, it has 57 million faces, which is quite high. So, a few case studies. Bookbindings. Bookbindings are not easy to capture, and to capture all the details. This is oblique lighting. Of course, with raking light, you see already much more. This is the shaded filter, where we take off, let's say, we take off color information, but it's actually the 3D information you see. It's the topography of the object. And then there's a sketch filter, but I will show later on some live examples. The measurement tool was implemented in 2014-2015. First of all, the shaded RGB image shaded filter. And this measurement tool is interactive. It measures in X and Y axis, but also what you see there in the blue. The blue is the topography of the object, of that line, sorry. Another example, but I show you more examples on that. But it shows you, it maps the difference in topography, difference in height on that yellow line. So if we can measure, we can also compare between treated and untreated condition. In this case, relaxation in Gore-Tex envelope. So already with the raking light, you immediately see a difference visually. This is with the shading filter, so it's the topography of the object without any color. It's a 3D information. And here are the measurements. I don't know if you can see that the graph on the right is more flat than on the left. But we can also export this data, and we can map it on each other. So there we can really compare before and after state, before and after conservation. Seals. This is with shaded filter. I'm just showing you screenshots. This is all can be done in an interactive manner. I will show you later on. This is with the sketch filter, which is works really well on seals and stamps and book bindings another example, embroidered textile binding. This is also with a shaded filter. This is another version of the shaded filter. This is the shading. This was the sketch filter, also the sketch filter and the shading filter. And if we zoom in, you can really see all the threads interweaving, which is really nice. I will show you this live after. So the multispectral microdome was developed in actually at the same time in order to share the same components and to have the same driver and so that the software can use the same software for the white light and the multispectral. We have five different spectra inside the dome. It's UV, blue, green, red, and infrared. And this distribution of the five spectra, we had a few discussions with the engineers. This is what it didn't become, because these were the more exotic distributions, but we chose this one, which is a more even distribution. So we have 46 LED lamps for each spectrum, evenly distributed on the inside of the dome. What you see during capture, it's not captured like that. It doesn't go as fast as that, but we start off with the blue, and each spectrum is captured one at the time. So we use the same software. We have our apochromatic lens, so everything stays in focus during UV and infrared. Since there are no movements, this is really important, we have a perfect registration. If you start using filters, it's possible that your camera moves or with this, we have no movement, so all our information is in perfect registration. And it's automated processing. We have the same interactive file, we have the same filters. We can choose between the individual spectra. We can have a combination of all those spectra. We have our five different normal. Five different infrared through UV, and we can combine all of them above. So five spectra, infrared 850 nanometers, red, green, blue, and UV 365 nanometer. Color images are always composed of three colors, and normal color imaging is composed of red, green, and blue, RGB. If we change the red with the infrared information, we have false color images, and some pigments show up different with infrared light than with normal light, for instance, or different with UV. What you see here are the five different normal images, ranging from the left infrared to UV. And I don't know if you see it, but the normal image on the right has more detail than the normal image on the left. And the effect you see here is actually infrared is a longer wavelength than UV, and infrared actually penetrates the object more before it reflects back. And that's why you see with infrared, for instance, an underdrawing sometimes. UV is a much shorter wavelength. It doesn't penetrate the object at all. It stays on top, it stays on the surface. So the 3D information we should capture with UV should be much more, we should see much more details compared to infrared. Now, this is theory, because you don't find many publications on that. This is a principle, but we were very happy to see that, well, to see a difference. So on the left you have the infrared, on the right you have the UV generated image. So on the right you see much more detail than the image on the left. What you see here is the RGB image with the on the left the 3D information of the infrared, and on the right the same colors but with the 3D information of the UV. So we can combine all this information, we can cross-link them all in an interactive way. But does it still stand compared to the white light microdome? So on the left you have the multispectral microdome with the infrared 3D information, on the right the multispectral with the UV information, and in the middle the white light microdome. And at first sight, in the middle you see much more information, but when you look at very minute details on the right you see even more. It's just slight difference of the angle of light, but the image on the right holds much more details than the image on the middle. And of course we can use this information and mingle everything. I will show you a live example in a few minutes. Just this has been implemented last year. It's a histogram which we as photographers all know, but it's a visual interpretation of the reflectance of the different spectra above the RGB, but the image below you will see five graphs of five different spectra. A second implementation is the reflection map, which gives you information about the material aspect of certain points in your object. And what you see is the reflectance of one pixel. What you see are the images, are the LEDs on the inside of the microdome. And it's a visualization of which LEDs reflected the most, the reflectance of each LED. So on top you have gold. Gold is very reflective. So when you think about reflection, an angle of light, and the more it reflects, the more shiny it is. And this is what you see above. What you see below is like a more coarse structure. It doesn't reflect, well, it also reflects, but it's a more diffuse reflection. This is why we don't have a high peak reflection like above. I will show that live. Okay. I'm just looking at the hour. This is what we've done already this at noon. It's ADD 8455 from this library. So we have our this is the viewer software. We have this icon which shows the angle of light, and so we can interactively change the position of light. If the icon is in the middle, it means that the light is coming from above. If I change the position of the light, the angle of the light also changes. So now there's raking light. I'm going to raking light coming from above. So, and we can interactively change this information, change the angle. We have the shaded version. So this is the pure 3D information. Since this is high resolution, I can go, I can show very minute details. We have a shaded and we have a shaded exaggerated, which is like a more contrasty version of the shaded filter. Something which works quite well with this kind of material is the sketch filter, which is like a kind of line drawing of your material based on height differences. And like in Germany, there is a large field of study in bookbindings, and bookbindings and stamps and seals are copied with laying a paper on it and with a pencil. With this, we don't need to touch the object. It's just captured information, processed information. So it's much safer, and we not only have this information, but we also have the color information. We captured this one in with a multispectral microdome. So what you see now is the RGB image, composed of the red, green, and blue. But I can hover between the individual spectra. This is the infrared, but I keep the interactivity between the spectra. This is the red spectrum, green, blue, and UV. I can combine those spectra to create false color. And this is a combination of the infrared, red, and green spectrum. Infrared, green, and blue. Red, green, blue. And green, blue, and UV. While keeping all interactivity. With the 3D information, and this is the normal layer. This is the infrared 3D information, and this is the UV information. It's detailed because it's only details change, but I hope you can see a difference. With other materials, you see much more difference. We can use this information, of course, or we can use the UV information with the 3D information from the infrared. Another example I will quickly show is of the Anjou Bible. It's one of the more, it's the most precious item in the collection of the university library. So it's also captured with the multispectral microdome, with the normal microdome. It has been studied very well, so we If we want to test new things, we use this as an example, because XRF analysis has been done with it and so on. But it came as to a surprise that with the multispectral microdome, you see maybe a difference between the RGB and the false color image. And this came to us as a surprise, because XRF analysis had shown that the blue was azurite, and suddenly something else appeared. So what was going on is that this blue layer was a combination of azurite and lapis lazuli. And lapis lazuli can be shown through XRF analysis, but it can be shown through multispectral imaging. And it's just lapis lazuli reflects different than azurite. And with the false color image, it shows up as a different color. With the RGB, it's uniform blue, but with the false color image, you see purple dots appearing. Given the time, this is what I could present. I don't know if there are questions.
So yes, thank you very much, Bruno. If you have any specific questions, we can spend another few minutes if you want to discuss something in particular. So please go ahead and raise your hand, or just ask the question.
Yeah. Does this have a use for reading palimpsests?
No, not yet. But it's also, well, one of the techniques we want to incorporate in algorithms we want to incorporate in the software is spectral unbinding and PCA, principal component analysis, based on the five different spectra. But with the UV, we've imaged, scratched out text, and with the UV, sometimes we get a result with the UV and with the blue. But specifically, palimpsest, no, not yet.
Any other questions? Okay, so maybe.
Was it that clear?
Maybe short one from me. So, what was the next stages for development of this technique?
I think hardware-wise, I think hardware-wise, we can have other spectra. We can incorporate other spectra, but I think the main advancement we will have will be based on software and software algorithms. So what we at the moment, as this is only version one of the software, the only measurement I will show that very quickly. The only measurement voilà. The only measurement tool we have is based on the first normal layer it sees, and at the moment is the infrared layer. So what we have here is the measurement tool, and it's the blue line is the change in topography of that. At the moment, in the multispectral version, only the measurement tool is only based on the infrared layer. So in the next version, and the engineers confirm me that it is already implemented, but they still need to hand me this version, we can choose between the five different normal images, five different 3D information sets. So we should see a clear difference between the infrared and the UV, certainly. Next also high on our priority list. Conservation-wise, it's not always very sensible to image with UV, so there will be a slider to capture without UV. Other processing algorithms such as principal component analysis is also something in on our list. And 3D information, export of 3D information to more useful formats is also something we want to work on.
When you're calculating the normal line,
does it
correct for the curvature of the page, for example?
Well, this has been no. First of all, we capture our 3D information from where the camera is a fixed position and the object is a fixed position, and the 3D information is calculated based on the different position of the lights. And this is relatively accurate, but it also always shows a curvature. This is why the measurement tool shows the measurement, the difference in texture between point A and point B. That's a first. No, so it calculates the curvature away. No, it just measures from point A to point B.
Hey, can I just ask quickly what language the view is written in?
I don't have.
Java or?
No, not Java.
Okay.
I think C.
Okay, great. Thank you very much for coming. And thank you very much, Bruno, for.
Thank you.